parents of children with asthma, here's another hit from the Breathe Easies.
Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke around the kids. In the house. Don't smoke in the car. Don't smoke in the house.
Don't break my heart.
Preventing asthma attacks can be as simple as making your home and car smoke-free zones. For more Breathe Easy tips to help stop asthma attacks, go to noattacks.org. Brought to you by the EPA and Yankee.
Hey, this is Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers for RAD. I'm here to remind you that drunk drivers are still a major killer of young adults in this country. So always choose a designated driver. And remember, music lives, you should too.
Getting on in the state of Mississippi. Papa was a copper and a mama was a hippie.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is H to the OV. I used to move snowflakes by the OC.
Hello, fans of all ages. We are indeed the Beasts of the East, Ryan Moore and Dean Rovantini here with you on this Wednesday, February 24th, 2015. No Scott Thompson here tonight. He's calling the men's volleyball game. I don't know who they're playing. Well, you can catch that game on Metaphor Athletics. You're here with us on WRPR 90.3 FM, the Beasts of the East on Ramapo College Radio. Dean, how are you doing today?
Good, good.
I think I started the day a little slow. The rain kind of bummed me out.
Right.
A little bit. But, you know, when you go get lunch with some friends,
right,
play some basketball.
We got our shots up today.
Got our shots up. Turned into a very nice day. So I'm happy to be here and talk about some sports.
Good, as am I. Still a little rainy and gloomy, but that's why we're here, the Beasts of the East. Ryan Moore, Dean Rovantini with you.
Yes, sir.
Right now, 6:02 here in Mahwah, New Jersey. Got a lot of baseball to talk about. We're going to get into some draft combine analysis, some NFL draft analysis as well. And if the time lets us, we're going to talk about the New York Knicks for a little bit because they have been on an extreme downslope after what was looking to be a promising season for them. But we'll get into it later on in the show. Feel free to call in whenever you please. 201-825-1234. That's 201-825-1234. First thing that I want to talk about is Mark Teixeira, Yankees first baseman, going into spring training. We are assuming fully healthy. The last 2 years have been pretty much bummers for him. 2013, he only played in not
many games.
2013 to 2014, I don't even think he played a combined 160 games. 2014, I don't even think he hit 30 or 40, right?
No.
Didn't he miss most of
2014? Yes, he did. That was the worst.
Right. And 2015, which was last season, he played in 111 games, was on an absolute tear.
Yeah.
He was, without a doubt, their MVP. I think he had 36 home runs.
Mm-hmm.
And then one evening, August 17th, I believe it was, he took a foul ball right to the shin. He was out for a couple of weeks. It wound up being a bruise, and then it was a 15-day DL. We didn't think much of it.
Yeah.
And then he just never got healthy. Mm-hmm. And then they wound up saying it was a stress fracture in the shin. He was out for the year. Of course, we saw the emergence from Greg Bird, but now Greg Bird is out for the year with a torn labrum. So Mark Teixeira is a starting first baseman. He wasn't not going to be. He is the starting first baseman for the Yankees. But he came out today saying that he wants to play for another 5 years. He's 35 years old. He wants to play until he's 40. He has the power. But the thing is, does he have the health? And last year was a freak accident. I get it.
Yeah.
Foul ball off the leg, whatever. The last couple of injuries, though, prior to that, really, it showed how unhealthy he really was. And he went into last year, he said, no more gluten, more sugar, this and that.
Yep.
He changed his entire diet, and everyone said he was shredded. And people on Twitter were saying, it's Greg Bird's time, you can't re-sign Teixeira, this and that. And I'm going to tell you why I think it's actually a good idea that they re-sign Teixeira after this year. I think that he's going to have a solid year this year if he stays healthy. And you know he's going to try to stay healthy because if he wants to play for five more years, he's going to really going to try and show it, especially in the contract year, last year of his contract. But the thing is, Greg Bird is out for the year, and I think that has a lot to do with Teixeira next season because the Yankees are going to want to give Greg Bird AAA at-bats. Remember, he was not starting this season with the Major League Ball Club unless he was tearing it apart. They wanted him to start out in the minors, and you can't expect a guy who only played in 45 Major League games to sit out an entire season and then start with the Major League Club in 2017. That's why I think that if you sign Teixeira to even a one-year deal, give him $17, $18 million, he's your first baseman, and you have the same exact process with Greg Bird that we're going to have this year, except you just push it back a year. Mm-hmm. It's not like Greg Bird is 25 years old, 26 years old, and he'll be a major by the time he's 27 or 28 years old. He's 22 years old. He's not going to make his debut now until he's 24 years old. That's not much of a stretch. And on top of that, let's say you sign Teixeira for 2 or 3 years. A-Rod is gone after the 2017 season, so you can move Teixeira to DH. You can move Greg Bird to first base. Mark Teixeira's defense at first base has not declined at all, no matter how badly he's gotten hurt. But I don't think it's a bad idea for the Yankees to re-sign him after this year if he plays well.
I think it's a smart idea. When we were talking about what we were going to talk today, walking over here, I was thinking the exact same thing you were saying. Hopefully he would take the... You know, obviously they're not going to give him the max. They're not going to give him that much money.
There's also a qualifying offer.
Yeah, very true. So, like, you know, I think if he's willing to take that, kind of, I guess you would say, not the minimum, but, like, less, you know, and play as kind of a, not a role player, but he, in a sense, he would be. Because, like you said, Greg Bird's not going to come back next year and be the starter. And you don't want to go out and sign a guy who, you know, a random guy or something for, say, 2 to 3 years, because then that will, in a sense, delay Bird as well. So you get a guy like Teixeira who you trust and who hasn't really shown anything yet that he's like, you know, bad or anything. He's on the decline,
right,
like you were saying. So really, I think it would be smart because, like you said, A-Rod is probably on his way out, you know, and then that DH spot opens where Mark Teixeira, obviously... Like we said, health-wise,
we'll get time over there.
Exactly, as well. So, and then maybe Teixeira plays, you know, a quarter of, probably less at first base sometimes to give Bird at that time rest or whatever. So I think it would work out if they do sign him to maybe I think 2 year deal would be fine, to be honest. Maybe not, one's too short, and I think 3 is too long. So I think 2 year would be perfect for it, you know.
Two things come into play. It's how Mark Teixeira does this year, because if he doesn't play well, then they would rather have Greg Bird start off the injury and call it quits. Or they can sign a free agent in the offseason. We'll get to that in a couple minutes also. We just pulled up the list.
Oh.
And the second option is what your plan is with Greg Bird. And, mm-hmm. and again, going back to these free agents, if you want the plan to be Greg Bird getting 400, 500 at-bats, that is actually pushing it a little bit. That's more like Aaron Judge's case. But if you want Greg Bird to get maybe 200 or so plate appearances, get him called up by about mid-May, early June.
Okay.
Again, it's the plan this year was – that was the plan this year for Greg Bird. Call him up in June or whatever. Would not necessarily wait until he's ready, but wait until he's – gotten a nice sample size where you can finally bring them up. And then if your plan is to just push that back to a year, then it's not a big deal, especially if Teixeira has a good year. If he doesn't have a good year and you still want Greg Bird to get minor league at-bats in 2017, which I think they should do, first base, here we go. Obviously, Teixeira is a free agent. Edwin Encarnacion, who's 33. James Loney. Kendrys Morales.
Those are good veteran bats. But Brandon Morales is more of a DH now.
That's true. Brandon Moss is on that list. Adam Lind. Mike Napoli. Mitch Moreland. Steve Pierce. Logan Morrison's not bad. You do have a lot of guys.
Nice
that,
lefty bats, too.
That, too. You can afford a lot of these players. I mean, Edwin Encarnacion.
He's too much. He would ask for too much.
He'll be too much. Yeah. You heard what Jose Bautista's asking for?
Ridiculous.
We can get into that because he was saying, there were rumors saying 5 years, $150 million. He was like, oh, that's not true. Turned out it wasn't true, but he was asking for more.
Yeah. Was it like $150 million? No, was it?
The original rumor said 5 years or $150 million. And then he said, no, that's not true. assuming, but we naturally assumed that he was asking for less. Turns out he's actually asking for more.
Is it from the Blue Jays too, right?
Right.
That's what he's asking for. Like, that's, dude. Like, I hate to say it. I know you've been there for a long time, but it's not your team.
I mean, he has a lot of help out. He has a lot to argue, though. He has the most home runs in the majors in 6 years. He hasn't declined at all. If anything, he's only gotten better.
But he's still, I mean, he's not a young guy.
No, he's 35.
Exactly. So it's like, you got to look at the club standpoint. They're going to invest in a guy like Donaldson, your reigning MVP. And they may be spending that money on him, and where they really do need another pitcher. So, like, I don't think they.
Exactly. Edwin and Bautista are both free agents.
Yeah.
Donaldson, you have to pay. They signed a 2-year, $30 million deal. So,
yeah, but that's
you have Donaldson leaving after next year.
Yeah, but you want to spend that money on him. You'd rather take him. He's the best third baseman in the league.
Yeah.
And he's probably the best hitter, right? Well, you know, one of the best hitters in the league as well, so.
Yeah, you know Bautista and Edwin aren't coming back.
No, you can't afford that.
They're both going to ask for way too much.
Exactly.
So you have Encarnacion, and I would take a pass on him. I was always a fan of James Loney. He's making
great veteran hitter.
He's making $9.5 million. He might ask for more just because it's the Yankees.
You think? Yeah. But you know what's funny? Like, I could never, like, I wouldn't be able to see him too. And like, cause like he played for the Rays,
Red Sox,
and not Orioles, but like still, it's kind of funny. But he's a good veteran bat, lefty bat.
Yeah.
Who did else have?
Brandon Moss is on the list. A lot of these guys are old, but you can at least sign them to a 2 or 3 year deal, just so Greg Bird gets into the swing of things. And you know what? You could sign Napoli.
Yeah.
Have Greg Bird come up to the majors in 2017. Maybe have Napoli as a backup.
That's true.
Because Mike Napoli, righty. Greg Bird, lefty.
Very true.
That could work out.
Yeah. I'm not a big fan of his defense, though.
No, but...
That's another guy, too, though. Imagine just him coming over.
Mike Napoli used to kill the Yankees when he was with Boston.
But then again, you never know. Like, he might be like, all right, hey, I smashed the ball in Yankee Stadium. Let me play there for majority of the season.
I just think that a lot has to go to Scherzer's way if he's going to be re-signed with the Yankees. I don't think that the Yankees are planning on it. I think that they were set on not bringing Teixeira back unless if he really went on a tear this year. He would have had to hit 40s. He would have had to do what he did this year, basically, but stay healthy if the Yankees are going to re-sign him. And again, that DH spot is going to be open in 2 years. And they're bringing up Gary Sanchez, so McCann's going to see a lot of time at DH. You might see Ellsbury and Garner see some time at DH with Aaron Hicks coming now.
That's very true.
Aaron Judge might get some time at DH even this year.
Mm-hmm.
They have a lot of options at DH, and this all goes back to the depth. Last year, they had no depth in that offense.
Yeah.
This year, they do. Of course, you lose Greg Bird, but you have Aaron Judge coming up. You have Dustin Ackley, who was hitting the ball very well for the Yankees last year. He's going to be their backup first baseman. You'll need a couple of guys to play first just to save Teixeira, but this all goes back to the depth that the Yankees finally have. They have not had depth at all the last couple of years. They finally have it. They have a very good middle infield. Third base, still a question mark with Chase Headley. I personally am a fan of him.
I like him.
I just think that he gets a bad rap. I mean, he had a terrible first half last year. But I thought he stepped it up in the second half. He only had 6 errors in the first half. He had about 20-something errors throughout the year, but only 6 of them were in the first half. And this guy's known for his defense.
Yeah.
He came to the Yankees in that trade last year, and they got rid of Solarte. And Solarte was
Last year? No, 2 years ago.
Last year. It was 2014.
Headley?
Yeah. It was 2014.
Last year was 2015.
Well, I meant like last year. Two seasons.
Sorry.
No.
Yeah. But
even Solarte was playing really well for them. They traded him, got Headley, and they really liked Headley's glove. Headley does make a lot of really good plays. Can't really make the routine one, but he has a lot of range.
Right.
He has a solid arm. I think he'll be all right. I just like the team this year. I think if they stay healthy, they are a very good team. We talked about the rotation the other day. They need a lot of things to go their way. But if those things do go their way, they are very good. They could be a dark horse of a rotation in the league. And again, if Teixeira stays healthy, they're dangerous. Stalin Castro and Didi, they are a dangerous middle infield. Brian McCann had career season power numbers wise last year, and he can only improve. Again, he had a second half slump average wise. His power numbers were still there, but he only hit 200 in the second half. And again, Aaron Hicks is going to be huge because that saves Brett Gardner, that saves Jacoby Ellsbury. You have Aaron Judge, you have Gary Sanchez. They have so much depth. I'm excited.
Yeah, I'm really excited. And I think, going back to this, I think it actually benefits the Yankees more, to be honest, because now you have these guys, all these young guys. The Yankees are becoming young again, even though we have a bunch of veterans on the team right now, which is good. And it excites you because you get to see these young guys come up.
Yeah.
And then you know, you like to see, you know, you have your veteran guys that you believe in every single day, you know, for the season. So I think it's a beneficial thing, what the whole Teixeira situation, because I think that after, I think A-Rod's, this is going to be his last year if he gets, like, all those records. You know, he's, I think he's, what was it, like, 33?
He's 13 away from 700.
Yeah.
So, do the math, 714 minus 687, 27?
Yeah, so it's, like, I mean, hey, it's possible. And I think if he does get it, he's going to be like, all right, I did what I wanted to do. I'm out. And there, where you have, you can re-sign Sheriff for cheap. I think he's very, I think he loves it in New York, and I think he would, you know, without a doubt, take a pay cut, because even next year, I think next year is going to be even more scary of a team.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because it's just more experience for guys like Gabby Sanchez. You have even Starlin Castro's in the system for another year. The pitching staff as well continues to grow. So, I don't know. I'm excited.
I have a good feeling, though, that Teixeira wants to have a good year, not because of money-wise. I think he wants to have a good year because he wants to stay with the Yankees. I feel like he's gotten involved in so much charitable work here. He loves the area. He loves the fans. He loves the team. He won a World Series with them his first year. So that automatically puts a good spirits in your heart. I just think that he wants to have a good year just so – I don't think he wants to go to another team because – he knows that feeling of what it was like. He got traded, three times?
Yeah, he bounced
in
around.
In two seasons, he bounced around. He found his home. I don't think he wants to do that anymore. And I think he would love to be a mentor to Greg Bird once he gets back. I think that he would be very much willing to take a pay cut with the Yankees rather than go to a team for more money. And I don't think that a team wants to necessarily sign him to be their starting first baseman, unless if he really, again,
especially
goes
at the age of 36. And plus, the other thing, too, like, think of from a player's perspective is, like, he was tearing it up. He was tearing it up before he got hurt. And it's like, you know, what if he didn't get hurt and maybe he continued that streak and just, so it's like, you motivate yourself to come back and say, man, I got to do this again, but I want to do it for the whole entire season. You know, I don't want to get, I'm not getting hurt again, but I'm going to tear that ball up like I did last year.
If Teixeira has a bad season, would you rather have Greg Bird start in 2017 or sign one of these guys and have them start for a little while?
I wouldn't want Greg Bird just because of what he's coming back from. Yeah, like, that's a tough injury.
Yeah.
And that's a whole year off of baseball. And you're asking him to start, be the starting first baseman in, like, New York.
You only
I mean?
Played 46.
Yeah.
46 games.
Exactly. So, like, that's a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure. So, I would like to, if Teixeira had a bad year, go out and see what you can get with those guys. And, you know, I mean, but I don't think he will, though. I don't know. I believe in Teixeira, I think.
I think that if he's healthy, because he's never had a bad season. I mean, he's never hit 300 in his career, but his power numbers have always been there when he's healthy. I think every year on the Yankees, when he's healthy, he's hit over 30 home runs. Even the year where he wasn't healthy, he hit around 20, 22, something like that, and he didn't even play in 100 games. So If he's healthy, he'll be really solid. And again, back to Greg Bird. They want him to see time in the minors. Mm-hmm. If he played a full season, I was just going to try to compare it to Severino, but the Yankees actually need that arm in that rotation.
Yeah. They don't really need Greg Bird, you know what I'm saying, because they have so much depth.
Right,
so,
exactly.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. But another thing about Teixeira, too, is from last year, is like Teixeira, his whole career was known for slow starts into the season.
Yeah.
Slow starts. That was not the case last year. Out of the gate, just boom, boom, boom. So, like, that's why I'm excited, like, that he's back. And that's why I think I believe in him a lot, too, because of that as well.
And you know what? This year, especially, if he goes off to a slow start, that'll get in his head because of contract situations. If he gets into a slow start, I think you can expect him to just have a bad year in general.
Yeah, you're probably right.
You wouldn't want to come out of the gate slow.
No.
And then, especially in the contract year, because everyone's going to rip on you and all that. Here's his career with the Yankees. Two-time All-Star, his first year in 2015. First year, 39 homers, 122 ribbies, and .292 average. He was second in MVP. I think Mauer won. Joe Mauer won. Teixeira was second, and Jeter was third that year. Won a gold glove, won a silver slugger.
I thought Jeter was second. Oh, no, that's the other year.
He won 3 gold gloves in 4 years, and he was a finalist last year. If he stayed healthy last year, he would have won that gold glove also.
You know, that was so funny. I find that funny how, like, you know, he missed, like, the pretty much half of the year. Well, not really, but, you know, and he was still a finalist for it.
Every game that he has played in over 125 seasons, every season he's played for over 125 games, he's hit more than 30 home runs. 2009, 156 games, 39 homers. 2010, 158 games, 33 homers. 156, 39. 123, 24. So do the math with that. 123 divided by... 123.
I'm a comm major. No,
24. Wait, hold on. No, you would do 24 divided by 123 times 162. So he was on pace to hit 31 home runs that year. He only played in 15 games in 2013, and he hit 3 home runs. Can't really
add
that up. 2013 was the short year.
Oh, my goodness.
2014, 123 games and 22 home runs. So that was the 1 year where he actually would have been on pace to have less than 30 home runs, but he would have had 29. And then last year, he hit 31 home runs in 111 games.
Man, dude.
So when he's healthy, he's really fine.
Yeah.
3 gold gloves in 4 years, a finalist last year, and got snubbed because he didn't play a full season.
Yeah.
When he's healthy, the guy is...
He's a top first baseman.
Oh, you can argue that right now anyway.
Yeah, I mean?
Ribby numbers. 100 in his first 3 years, 84, 58, and 59... Yeah, the last two seasons, the RBI... Oh, I was looking at... even 62 and 79, the RBI numbers are low because no one got on base.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, the offense... I mean, I feel like every home run was a solo home run. Except, well, they splattered a couple here and there. But his slugging also, .548 last year, .565 in his first year. He's constantly in the .480s and .490s range. He's hit .500 in the slugging a couple of times.
Yeah.
His on-base is up. If he's healthy... He can be very successful. Ryan Morick, Dean Rovitini, Beast of the East on WRPR 90.3 FM. Don't go anywhere. Some more baseball. Actually, no. If you guys want to call in, 201-825-1234, we're down to talk about baseball still. But we're going to get into some NFL draft combine analysis. What should the Giants do? What should the Jets do in the NFL draft? And this upcoming offseason, free agency starts in about 3 weeks. 3 weeks from, 2 weeks from Friday, I believe it starts. So don't go anywhere. Ryan Warwick, Dean Rovitini, and all of you listening right here on WRPR 90.3 FM.
You're listening to WRPR Mawa.
Now that's a face for radio.
Hey, this is Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers for Rad. I'm here to remind you that drunk drivers are still a major killer of young adults in this country. So always choose a designated driver and remember, music lives, you should too. Getting on in the
state of Mississippi. Papa was a copper and the mama was a hippie.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Alright, Shaquille O'Neal for Rad. It's not your normal PSA. Don't be stupid. Don't drink and drive. If you're gonna go out and have a good time, it's fine. But designate a driver to drive home. Let's stop the madness. Don't drink and drive.
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Didn't I play this on Monday?
Yes.
Did I?
I think so.
Alright,
it doesn't really matter.
No, it matters. I don't like repeating songs.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
So we'll put on Future.
Okay.
You realize how loud the speakers are in our room, by the way? George and Mike just walked in. Mike and I were doing laundry. It's loud.
Yeah, you're alive.
Yeah, you're on.
Piece of these. Fine work, D-Martin.
Welcome. Hello. How's that popcorn?
It's pretty good. Future is life, so you gotta bump it, you know?
I guess so.
Ryan Warwick, Dean Rovatini, Beast of the East, joined by G-Unit and Mike Danino. What was I gonna say? Oh, yeah. You have updates for us, right?
Yeah, short and simple.
You claim you do.
They're really short and simple.
All right, well, give it to us anyway.
All right, what's up, people? My short and simple updates for the week. Right now, in 30 minutes, 7 o'clock, in the Bradley Center, the men's volleyball is taking on Kane. Scott Thompson, our own Scott Thompson, will be on the call.
Our own,
whatever. Okay.
No, I was just saying.
What are you saying?
I was just saying, like...
Okay. I thought I said that.
Oh, sorry. No, you did.
As for the pros, not much really going on besides Devils beating the Rangers last night in convincing fashion with a 5-2 victory. Upsetting for me, but
did you see Blandisi flop again?
No, I didn't.
It was arguably... No, it wasn't worse than the first one, but it was still pretty bad.
And that's all I got. It's really short. There's nothing going on. And plus, we did Monday?
Yeah, we did them on Monday. I can think of a couple of things.
Go ahead.
The Knicks got destroyed.
Okay. Knicks got Jimmer, the best player in the D-League.
Oh, best player of all time. A couple of NJAC champions in track. Jeremy Hernandez won the mile. Michael Began won the shot put. Who else? Can't remember off the top of my head. Paul Julius won something. I don't remember. Michael B. Ox. Kid's huge. He doesn't know who I am, but shout out to him.
He probably doesn't listen to
who knows. If he is, good for you. Congratulations to all members of the track team for a solid season. And once again, Scott Thompson at the Bradley Center. You can tune into that game on RamFOAthletics.com. That game will start at 7 o'clock.
Tune in.
Yeah, please tune in. Support Scott. That'd be awesome. Real quick, just want to give a shout out to the New Jersey FNBA and the New Jersey PBA are playing in a charity hockey game this Saturday, February 27th, at 4 o'clock p.m. The game is at the Prudential Center.
Wow.
They're playing at the main arena, so they will be on the main ice. My cousin, Officer Vinny Sajazy, will be playing in that game for the NJPBA. Tickets are $20 for kids ages 7 to 17. Tickets for adults, are $20. Tickets for children 7 to 17 are $10. Children under 7 are free. I will be covering that game for WRPR, so I'll be sitting in the press box, being in the locker room.
Oh, cool.
Talking to all the firemen, the police officers. It's going to be a lot of fun. All proceeds go to Alex's lemonade stand, so please go and support. Go out, buy some tickets. They're still available. Check out njfmba.com for more information. Going to be a really fun event. Once again, game is at Prudential Center. So
that's really
should
awesome.
Be a lot of fun. Yeah, I get to cover my cousin. That's
have
cool.
fun.
Yeah, that's going to be a little different. I mean,
yeah, but if he doesn't like what you say,
you can't show favoritism.
I'll be able to show favoritism.
No,
I technically shouldn't.
You really shouldn't. Yep.
Okay, how's that thing?
I'm enjoying life.
Which one?
Which one? I meant the candy.
Power bar.
Speaking
of okay.
Power bar.
Speaking of power. NFL Combine.
NFL. Hey, I see what you did there. So the NFL Combine started. NFL Combine started yesterday, and we just want to talk about what the Giants should do, what the Jets should do.
Okay.
We'll start with the Jets because they did have the better season. I think that this season is pretty important to them. Upcoming, they went 10-6. I guess they're one piece. I don't even know if they're one piece away from being a playoff team. I think that they should have made the playoffs. They had a couple of bad losses last year. You look at the games against the Texans. You look at the game against the Raiders. And you look at Week 17, all games that they could have won, should have won, and just did not perform well at all. If they win those games, they are a 13-3 team. Again, one win away. They control their own destiny heading into Week 17, and they blew it. They wound up not making it again. They still are a solid team, though. I thought they were going to make the playoffs. I don't think they're any pieces away. I think that they have to re-sign Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Yeah.
I think that the chemistry he has with Brandon Marshall and Eric Decker is like none other. And you look at the stats, and you look at Geno's stats and Mark Sanchez's stats before Ryan Fitzpatrick took over, and Fitzpatrick's stats blow theirs out of the water, and it's really not even a contest. Ryan Fitzpatrick is, without a doubt, the best quarterback the Jets have had in the since Brett Favre, and even Fitzpatrick's stats this year were better than Brett Favre's stats. His 1 year with the Jets, I think that Fitzpatrick has to stay. Is he inconsistent? Yes, but when he's hot, he's hot. He played very well toward the end of the season. And I'm sure that they are at this draft combine looking very hard at potential players. I think that if they have a solid draft, if they get a couple of steals, then they are without a doubt in the playoffs this year. Again, a couple of losses away in games that they could have won and should have won but didn't. Go ahead.
I don't know. I like you said, they should have made the playoffs last year. And I think defensively, they're complete. I really think they probably have the top defense in the league. Because I don't think Ivory's going to sign back. So I think that they have to get a running back, and there's two nice running backs in the draft. A lot of people have them going middle towards end. So I think that
right in the Jets' hands.
Yeah, right in the Jets'
possibly.
Hands. So I think that's the only spot that they need to really fill.
Well, they're going to lose DeMario Davis, so they're going to – I think they're going to draft a linebacker and then probably a running back in the second round, which is what most mocks have.
Would you rather have them go out and sign – what's the bigger need for them, running back or linebacker?
I honestly think it's linebacker. I think running back's just not an important position. It's just not. You could fill in so many players. You don't even need a running back to win in the NFL anymore.
That's true. That's a good point. I mean, Ivory played really badly late in the year, and they still got it done. So would you rather them shop for a linebacker in free agency, or would you rather them pick up a linebacker in the draft?
Draft. I'd rather have the running back from free agency. Because Ivory was a free agent. He was a fourth-string running back on the Saints, and look how good he was. I feel like there's so many guys that could come in and be a good running back. DeMario Davis has over 100 tackles, like, almost every season. And he's a huge – that's a huge loss. Also, Cromartie said he wants to re-sign for less money, so that would be huge.
I don't think the Jets are really want him back,
though. Would they take him, though?
But if he signed for, like, no money, they would, yeah.
But he's going to be your, what, fourth string?
I guess so.
His kids.
I'm going to look up
– that's true, Mike.
I'm looking up NFL free agents, see what they can pick up. Forte – do the Jets have cap space to get Forte?
Yeah. They
have to re-sign Wilk.
They said Harrison or Wilkerson is a franchise tag option, and they're going to re-sign Fitzpatrick.
They have,
which they should.
I honestly think that's their main priority.
Yeah.
No, they will. They definitely will. I don't think that's a question. I feel like people are making that a question, but 100% they're going to re-sign him.
Yeah.
They know that.
I mean,
He literally had the best season ever for a Jets quarterback, ever, all time, statistically.
Really?
Yeah.
I know.
You can really argue it.
Yeah.
And especially with, I mean, I don't know the stats off the top of my head, but within the last 10 years...
Oh yeah,
it's
I mean, not even a contest.
He set the record. He only threw 30 touchdowns. He set the record.
Wow. He threw 30 touchdowns and set the Jets franchise
record. That's the Jets franchise record. 30. What 30 touchdowns? The record was 29 by Vinny Testaverde before that.
Wow.
Huh.
That's bad. Not even Namath.
See, but
that wasn't really a passing.
Yeah, it wasn't a passing league. Namath was probably the best quarterback they've ever had, but it wasn't a passing league.
Right.
Well, that's what, when you first said that, that's the first name of the team. I was like, no way. But then again, the league has changed a lot.
So you said you would rather them get a linebacker in the draft?
Yeah.
Who would they possibly get? What pick do they have? 20th.
Which is literally the worst pick in the draft.
Yeah.
They literally the worst pick.
They could trade up.
Yeah, but what are you going to give away?
Yeah, no, they're not going to trade up. They're going to just take the best player there.
Do they want to trade away Wilkerson? They're going to get...
No, they're definitely going to franchise Wilkerson.
They're
going to
franchise tag Wilkerson.
100% because he broke his leg. They're not going to give him a contract right after he breaks his leg. So.
Right.
And then Harrison might be gone.
Hmm.
Well, you know, I think Von Miller's staying with Denver. What are the linebackers on the market?
DeMarcus Ware might leave, they said.
DeMarcus Ware
might leave.
Really? Yeah.
I thought he would stay.
But he's a pass rusher, like outside linebacker. The Jets are going to need a middle linebacker, guy who tackles.
That's true. So who's on the list? They actually don't have any middle linebackers on this list for a while. They're all inside or outside.
David Harris is going to retire soon, too, so they're going to lose.
David Harris has, what, two years left on his contract?
Something like
that, Did he sign a three-year deal?
Mm-hmm.
I think if they want to, they could trade up. I hear this guy Shaq Lawson is – I mean, I don't know much about college players, but I hear that he is a stud. Who's the guy from Northern Kentucky that everyone thinks the Giants are going to get? What's his name?
Oh, didn't Scott do, like, a thing on him?
I think so.
I forgot his name.
I can't remember, but everyone's saying he's a stud. Those are the top two linebackers, and they're projected to go 10 overall. So if the Jets' biggest team need is a linebacker, they're going to have to trade up. And again, it all goes down to – who do you want to give up? Unless if you trade with a team that doesn't necessarily, I mean, every team has a team need, but if a team could afford trading down, you can simply just trade draft picks and then like a fifth rounder or a sixth rounder, that could work. Or if you want, get a running back first round, you can get Elliott, you can get Derrick Henry possibly, I don't know where. I heard Derrick Henry's actually projected second round.
Yeah, it's possible. It's because of Trent Richardson and Eddie Lacy just got really fat. It's because of the guys before
Is that actually legit?
That's like, a legit reason, yeah, because he's the same thing, except he's bigger. They're afraid it's going to be the same thing. I would be afraid, too.
He's
Trent Richardson is awful.
Eddie Lacy.
So is Trent Richardson.
I think they were always naturally, like, heavy, though. Derrick Henry is...
He's a monster.
Lacy was already heavy. Richardson really just didn't have an eye for the football field.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even that
he couldn't find holes at all.
And they were literally right in front of him. Mm-hmm. It's not even about him being heavy. He just had no football IQ. He had no IQ from the backfield. Ryan Warwick, Dean Rovatini, George Hunkley, and Mike Danino on Beast of the East, WRPR 90.3 FM, Ramapo College Radio. Feel free to call in with your thoughts. 201-825-1234, talking a little draft combine. Let's get into the Giants now. Did you hear what Ben McAdoo said at his first press conference?
About the win.
We have to end the game with the lead.
Is that there?
So this is the new Giants head coach.
He's got the right mindset. I mean, really.
That's true.
You score more than the other team, that's always good.
I've heard that's good. You can't lose in the games in the NFL and still win.
Nope.
You heard that one before?
I've heard it once.
I wish I had that pulled up right here.
Like, you know what he meant, though? You know what he meant when he was saying that.
Yeah.
But everyone just rips him anyway.
Yeah, because it sounds so silly.
Not lose game. I actually saw a tweet where it was like, did he pull a page out of Trent Dilfer's book? I thought that was pretty funny. But, yeah, Ben McAdoo has a lot of work, but I think that the Giants are relying more on free agency than they are on the draft because they have the second most cap space out of anyone in the league. I think that – I mean, obviously, I don't want them to have a bad draft, but I think that they are going to rely more on free agency because there are a lot of studs. And again, people are saying linebacker, Shaq Lawson, this guy from Kentucky. I'd be cool with those picks. A lot of people are saying that they can trade down for Derrick Henry or Elliott. I personally like Rashad Jennings. I think that he improved a lot later on in the season. Are Derrick Henry and Elliott better than Jennings? Yes, but I don't think they're that much better to the point where you waste the 10th pick on him or a first-round pick on him.
Because
you still have Jennings, who is very good. I mean, if they needed a running back badly, then you go and jump out. But they don't necessarily need it. Would you like one? Of course. I would love if they signed Fortet. I would love if they got Henry. I would love if they got Elliott.
They need a linebacker.
But they need a linebacker. I think they're going to rely on the linebacker core in the draft, and I think that they'll rely on safety help or D-line help in free agency. I think they would rather have the young linebackers, people who can chase down the quarterback, and people who can chase down receivers in the middle of the field. Because how many times do we see that Unga guy? At one point he led the team in tackles because they just fed any receiver who was near them.
Yeah.
That's the only reason why he had a lot of tackles, because everyone just shoved the ball right down the linebacker's throat. I mean, I like Devon Kennard a lot. John Beeson just retired, but that's not really...
He barely was there.
If he was healthy, he was awesome, but that was his problem. And that was honestly a good move for the Giants. They traded a 7th-round pick for him because he couldn't stay healthy.
Mm-hmm.
I think that they have to get linebacker in the draft and save the other big positions in free agency. I think that you want veteran players on the line and in the safety help, especially in the safety help, because they are young there. Landon Collins with a year off of his back. They're going to get Bennett Jackson back, but again, a year off and a young guy, you want someone to step up and fill that role and mentor him. Same thing goes for that. What's his name? Nat Berhe, I think. I don't even know what Cooper Taylor's deal is. But I think they need veterans to fill the role in the safety and especially the D-line. I would have loved if they re-signed Justin Tuck, but he retired. Not even just for skill purposes, because Justin Tuck obviously can't play anymore. But just to have that guy who knows the system, who is a veteran, who loves the Giants, I think it would have been awesome if they re-signed him. But obviously that can't happen. Who knows what they're going to do with JPP. All I know is that they need a linebacker in the draft, and whether they get Lawson or the guy from Kentucky, I don't know. I don't really know the difference between them two. But I think that's what they have to do.
I agree with that. You hit it right on the nose. I think the main target in the draft is going to be linebackers, because when's the last time the Giants really had a good linebacker? You know what I mean?
When was the last time they had a good linebacker?
Their last
Pierce, legitimately.
But was he like? He's not. He wasn't really like a top linebacker, though.
Lawrence Taylor was okay.
He was okay.
Yeah.
He was all right.
I've heard he's been. He was all right.
He's all right.
Who was their last good linebacker?
They never really had one.
No.
And I think that's something that the Giants need to just get finally. And is it one of those guys in the draft? Maybe, but you know, you're not going to find that out if you don't draft one. So.
I think they helped themselves a lot. I think hiring McAdoo as the head coach was literally the best thing they could have done. I think it was really smart.
So do I.
Because if you bring another head coach in, you either A, McAdoo and him might not get along if you keep McAdoo, or B, you have to get rid of McAdoo and Eli has to learn a whole new system.
Oh, yeah, restart all over again.
They did the perfect job by hiring McAdoo as the head coach, and that's definitely going to help a lot.
Eli Manning is literally the only reason why they hired Ben McAdoo. Mm-hmm. He is the only reason.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, could Eli adjust to a new system? Yeah, because he did it 2 years ago when he's been playing really well.
It just happened, though, yeah.
Right, but it's not like he had to adjust to the system. It's not like he slowly increased every year. First year in the system was amazing. Second year now in the system, even better. They needed to keep that system. He's thrown for 14 interceptions the last 2 years after throwing 27
and
the year
four,
before
four
that.
Four were in one game, right? Or five?
Last year, five were in one game.
So nine besides that.
The thing is with Eli, so many interceptions aren't his fault either, because his O-line has been terrible, so he's been rushed to throw. So many receivers drop the ball.
Yeah, a lot of them were like...
Not that one guy, though.
Batted up.
What's his name?
What one
That
guy?
One decent receiver they have?
Odell?
The Beckham guy?
Beckham guy,
the yeah. Cam?
He's a character.
You see that meme, Hotel Beckham Jr.? Like,
oh, yeah, you know, that was
dumb,
so funny.
The dumb tweet account?
I know, yeah.
Oh, that's funny. Who's on the market
for
that
what?
they could try to get?
They were trying to get Sanu, 100%. I think that would be a great second or third receiver.
Like, I think, yeah, if you're the definitely. Giants, I mean, they said that they're going to re-sign Victor Cruz. But honestly, I really think you have to go into this season assuming that he's not even going to play.
Or he's your third receiver.
Or he's your third receiver.
Well, McAdoo says he's going to be playing. That's
Randall's out. And I think Sanu would be really perfect.
I don't think they want Reuben Randall back. I certainly don't want Reuben Randall back.
They signed that French guy.
They signed
6'5" French dude.
Yeah, Jerry Reese, $60 million in cap space. What are you gonna do?
They signed a French guy and a Canadian football guy.
Eric Weddle's on the market.
I think he's gonna stay with the Chiefs. And I think
Chargers.
What?
Weddle.
Oh, I thought you said Eric Berry. Sorry.
No. Could get Eric Berry too, but not Eric Berry.
He's on the stats.
But Weddle's out though.
I don't think
they're not good. He wants to win.
Right.
He wants to go somewhere he can win.
Yeah. Come to New York.
New York City.
Jets, baby.
New York City kid. NYC getting the ring.
That was wow.
Have you heard that?
Yes.
Oh, wait until you hear his song.
I want to hear a little bit.
What, New York City kid?
Yeah.
I'm not playing it
close,
on here.
Close
absolutely
on it.
Not.
And, and there goes his career.
you're done. Ryan Moore, Kim Robertini, George Hunkley, Mike Dinino sitting in the back. WRPR 90.3 FM, Radical College Radio. We'll be back after this.
You're listening to WRPR Mawa.
Now that's a face for radio.
It's perfect. It's unbelievable.
It's a miracle.
It's a TV dinner.
It's WRPR. Mawa Ramapo Radio.
It could change the world.
Hey, parents of children with asthma, here's another hit from the Breathe Easies.
Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke around the kids. Don't smoke in the car. Don't smoke in the house.
Don't break my heart. When you're sick and smoke in the kids, it can trigger the asthma.
Preventing asthma attacks can be as simple as making your home and car smoke-free zones. For more Breathe Easy tips to help stop asthma attacks, go to noattacks.org. Brought to you by the EPA and the Ad.
Hey, this is Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers for Rad. I'm here to remind you that drunk drivers are still a major killer of young adults in this country. So always choose a designated driver. And remember, music lives, you should too.
Getting on in the state of Mississippi. Papa was a copper and a mama was a hippie.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Efficiency interviews are brought to you by the U.S. Department of Energy and the Ad Council.
Lisa, do you always leave your stereo on in the other room?
Oh, well, I was going to turn it off, but everybody makes mistakes. Everybody has those days.
You're just repeating the lyrics to Hannah Montana's song.
Okay, I'm turning it off.
Millions of kids are using their energy wisely. What's your excuse? Learn more at loseyourexcuse.gov.
Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne. For many years, you know I've had a drink problem and I'm trying to battle that problem every single day. But one thing I don't do, I don't drive my car when I'm drinking. I get someone to drive me. Do not drink and drive. It's the stupidest thing. If you drink, just don't drive. Not only are you going to hurt yourself, you may hurt some other person and you wouldn't want that on your conscience, would you?
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Beast of the East, Ryan Mark, Dean Rovatini, and more right here on WRPR 90.3 FM. So, we mentioned before that I will be covering a charity hockey game. Excuse me. You like the song choice, by the way?
Yes.
Roger Bob Johnson, thanks. So, like I said, I'll be covering a charity football. Why do I keep saying that? Charity hockey game at Prudential Center. It's the NJFNBA against the NJPBA this Saturday at Prudential Center, and we have one of the members of the NJPBA, who also happens to be my cousin, Officer Vinny Sajazy. Vinny, welcome to the show. Thanks for calling in. How's everything?
Good. How you guys doing tonight?
We're not too bad. All right. So tell us the whole situation. How did this whole thing get started? Whose idea was it? You know, the whole gist of it.
Actually, the New Jersey State PBA hockey team is kind of newly formed. We played in a summer league out of Prudential Center, which was cool. But the fire guys stayed and had a hockey team for a while. And, you know, the fire departments and the police departments worked so closely together. You know, we all figured out we had a hockey team, so we said, well, let's get a charity game going. And the PBA and the SMBA are so big into helping the community. We figured, what better way to raise the money?
Not bad. How did you guys settle on Alex's Lemonade for the proceeds?
It's actually, this whole charity is going to be going through the fire department. They set up this particular game.
Okay.
So they chose the charity Alex's Lemonade, which is a great cause because it's, you know, children dealing with cancer, and we all know that's financially consuming for a lot of families. So any little bit can help.
So you've played at the practice rink for the Devils. How excited are you to play on the main ice?
You know, I'm very pumped. I'm a huge hockey fan. I'm a diehard Rangers fan. But, you know, you respect the Devils because they're a pro team. And, you know, you're going to be playing.
You respect the Devils? I haven't heard that those words come out of your mouth ever.
Well, I respect that they're a professional
team. All right.
Respect the arena.
Yeah, that's
good. I mean, I'm excited.
Yeah, that's going to be a lot of fun. I can't wait to be there. Again, thanks a lot for that press pass. That's going to be a lot of fun. Are you going to be in the home locker room or the away locker room? Do you know yet, or?
No clue. I know the way the arena is set up. There's access to the practice arena directly from the main arena. So my guess is we're going to use probably the locker rooms in the practice arena and then be able to walk through. That's my guess. I know we're not going to be in the Devil's locker room.
Right.
You know, it's a great facility. They have a great setup over there where the practice facility is directly attached to the main arena, and that's class. Eh? If you've ever seen those GoPro videos with the NHL, they're filmed in the Pavilion Health Center, which is the practice arena, and it's awesome. The quality, just the practice arena, is amazing compared to the local rink, so I could just imagine what the main arena is going to be like.
Yeah, I'm excited. That's going to be a lot. How many tickets have you guys sold so far?
I know they're on their second round of printing tickets. And I know the second round they asked for almost like 700 extra tickets.
Not bad. Wow.
So it's going to be a huge turnout. You know, you figure the state PBA police department and the state fire department association. So, you know, that's from top of New Jersey to the bottom of New Jersey that gets represented by both organizations. So it should be a huge turnout.
You know, I've never seen you play hockey.
I can't believe. That's surprising to me because I've been playing my whole life, but I guess, you know, you went to Florida for those 2 years. So
that's true. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You played that whole time while I was down there. That's right.
Yeah. Michael and I used to go to camp when we were younger.
That's right. Oh, man. I can't believe that. I got to come to some of your games. You still play at the practice rink, right?
Well, no. We can't play there now because the NHL season's going on. So we play there during the summer.
That's sweet. I gotta check some of those games.
My biggest worry for Saturday is the first few minutes of the game not getting taken out because I'm gonna have my head up staring around looking at everything.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I mean, we didn't play at a pro stadium, but when Dean and I, we played at Staten Island, we played at the Somerset Patriots Arenas. I mean, the arena stadiums.
Ballpark, even that's nice.
Yeah.
That's professional. You know, that's professional ball.
Yeah, I mean, it's not anything like Yankee Stadium, but I know the New York High School Championships were at Yankee Stadium. I couldn't imagine.
I would lose it.
Yeah, we went nuts playing at those little stadiums. I can't imagine what you're going to be like. You think you're going to get that dub?
I think so. I think we're going to have a great game, a huge turnout. But the main thing is going to a great cause, you know, Alex's Lemonade Stand. So regardless if anybody wins, they're still going to make out.
That's sweet. All right. Vinny, thanks a lot for coming on. We really appreciate it. Can't wait. I'm sure you're excited, too.
I can't wait.
Yeah, I'm sure. All right. Say hi to the boys out of Adrian for me. I'll talk to you guys later.
All right. Have a good one, boys. Thank you.
All right. We'll talk to you. So, yeah, make sure you come out. Still a lot of tickets available. Going to be a really fun event. You just heard him say it. A lot of people are showing up for this big charity event. All proceeds go to Alex's Lemonade Stand Saturday, 4 o'clock at the Prudential Center. Before we wrap it up, let's get into some New York Knicks basketball. This season started out pretty promising for them. We saw what Kristaps Porzingis can do. He has not dropped off in any way, shape, or form. But the Knicks as a whole have. They competed against some solid teams, but they just can't seem to get the job done. We saw a lot of games where they were this close, especially the game against the Oklahoma City Thunder. They had a four-point lead with a minute left. They let it go, and then they were back and forth in overtime. Thunder wound up taking it. But that's their problem. They don't have an identity. They play good against good teams, and they play badly against bad teams. They went to double overtime against the Sixers. They lost to the Nets. I think right now we're really starting to see their true colors. They got murdered against the Raptors on Monday night. That is the team that we're used to seeing, a team who is consistently bad against good teams and, I guess, mediocre or good against bad teams. We saw them compete, and right now we're not seeing it. And Melo's not playing well. Really, the only thing is – the only thing going for them is Porzingis. Robin Lopez is really terrible. Jose Calderon has been an absolute bust.
He scores 7 points a game. That's it. Starting Calderon? Point guard. Yeah, 7 points a game. Starting point guard.
That can happen.
Robin Lopez is playing great D, but
that's what he's known for, though. Like, when they signed him, they should have known that. Like, he's not a scorer. Like, right. They got him to stay there and get rebounds and hopefully block every other shot, maybe.
I don't think they have enough scorers, personally.
They have one score. They have Carmelo when he's
averaging. Porzingis put up 15 a game. Like, he doesn't even put that up, so.
Yeah.
Who's their second go-to? Aflalo?
It's Aflalo, yeah.
He scores, what, like 13 a game. How are they supposed to beat NBA teams who's scoring on this team?
But what I don't understand is how come they were competing against good teams at one point in the season? They started off the year really well. What was their win total last year? 17? They got that one. I think before the new year. No, it wasn't before the new year.
It might have been.
No, I think it was.
Was it?
They've lost like nine out of 11, yeah. or they lost 8 in a row.
It might have been right before the new year, or yeah, I think so. But to be honest, like, I'm not surprised where they are right now. I didn't think they were gonna have a great season. I was surprised in the beginning because they were kind of.
You look at their record and you say, okay, this is what you expected. But you look at what they did in the beginning of the year and you say to yourself, how in the world did this happen? Difference? Like, what happened? Yeah. They were a good team. Well, I shouldn't say a good team, but at one point they had a playoff spot. The East. The lower half of the East is better than the lower half of the West. I mean, you look at the standings and I think
Chicago's dropping. So the 8 seed's open because Chicago will keep dropping without Jimmy Butler.
That's true.
Yeah.
You have to be like 500 to get the 8 seed. The Knicks are 10 games below 500.
Right. How many games back are they? 10?
They're of the 8 seed. They're six and a half back. But they'd basically have to go. There's 24 games left. They'd have to go 10 games over 500.
Last week, they were like 3 games back. They're declining so fast. And, I mean, people want to say that they should have traded Melo. They say they wanted to trade Melo. I don't know why you would want to trade Melo. He's your only scorer, unless if you got some really solid trade bait back. But who's going to give up something huge for Melo who has not been performing? And remember, Melo wanted to stay in New York.
Yeah.
He had Chicago in the palm of his hands, and he said, no, I want to stay in New York. So, I mean, I don't know if the deal includes any no trades or anything like that, which it probably does. But people wanted to trade Melo. I don't get it. He's their best player. You're not going to get any solid player in return because he has not been performing well. I think if you're the Knicks right now, looking forward – you have draft picks in the next couple of years, obviously. They're going to have cap space. Who do you work the team around, Melo or Porzingis?
I think you just got to – I mean, it's hard to say because this is a team that's not going to be good now. They're not going to be contenders next year or the year after that. It's a team that's going to be a work in progress. and it's going to happen with draft picks, maybe free agency, but I really don't see, like, any... I feel like New York isn't that ideal place anymore because how they...
Is the Garden still mecca of basketball?
If the Knicks are in the playoffs, it's way better for basketball.
That's true. I think you still have to consider it.
I think they should trade now. It definitely is, but I feel like it's not anymore. I don't know. Like,
It is what it isn't. Because
yeah. Well, it's still it. It's still that, but like I feel like guys don't look at it like that anymore.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't know. I think they still have a solid future in their hands. It could be worse. It could be the Nets, who have, what, one first-round draft in the next 3 years. They have zero future. So yeah. It could be worse, Knicks fans. Ryan Moore, Dean Roventini, and more right here on Beast of the East, WRPR FM, 90.3 FM, I should say. We'll be back on Monday, 6 o'clock p.m. Eastern time. It's not goodbye. See you later. So long, and take care, everybody. Get cracked, check your trap, come back, get back. That's the part of success. If you believe in the X, you'll be relieving your stress.